very few words strike fear in the hearts of beekeepers as much as the word Varroa. Varroa is a devastating mite that absolutely kills our colonies and requires our management, and it's a global problem. So in this video, I want to talk a little bit about Varroa, its biology, its life cycle, and the damage that it does to honeybee colonies. I hope to use this video to convince you to take Varroa seriously. Failure to take Varroa seriously and your honeybee colonies are going to die. So you really need to know as much as you can about this pest. And I'll start with its name, Varroa. Well, Varroa is a bit of a misnomer because that's only the genus name that goes with a handful of species of mites. And when beekeepers say Varroa, most often they are talking about one species, and that is the species destructor. So Varroa destructor is the mite that we are concerned most about in our honeybee colonies. Prior to 2000, this mite was identified as Varroa jacobsoni. In 2000, it was identified as Varroa destructor. Jacobsoni is still a species, but destructor is the one that's recognized as being the one that is spread around the world and is causing the damage that we see. Why is Varroa so damaging to our honeybee colonies? Well, it's really simple. Most species of Apis, honeybees, live in Asia. And one species in particular, Apis serrana, is actually the natural host of Varroa destructor. Apis serrana is a bee that can actually host this mite with very little damage to the colonies. On the other hand, beekeepers moved honeybee colonies from Europe, specifically Apis mellifera, the species that's kept most broadly around the world, into Asia, where Apis mellifera first encountered Varroa destructor. Now, Apis mellifera doesn't have natural Varroa pest in its colony. This is the first time Apis mellifera had ever seen a Varroa species, let alone destructor specifically. And once destructor made it into Apis mellifera colonies, the rest is history. Upon leaving Asia, Varroa was first found in Europe, and that's when it began being recognized for the problems that it causes in honeybee colonies. From Europe and other parts, it just spread around the world. It was found in the United States in 1987, and when Varroa moves into an area, it instantly becomes the most significant threat to honeybee health in that area. So beekeepers, again, commonly refer to this as Varroa, but it's more appropriately referred to as Varroa destructor, given that there's a number of species. From henceforth in this video, when I say Varroa, I specifically mean the species destructor. So Varroa destructor, once it moves into an area, as I've stated, quickly becomes the problem that honeybee colonies face. Varroa's really bad, and its life cycle is key to that. But I want to talk, before speaking about its life cycle, a little bit instead about how it spreads once it moves into an area. So imagine that you have this colony that is Varroa positive that is now in your apiary. And let's just say, for the sake of argument, your other colonies don't have it. Well, Varroa can spread from that one colony to neighboring colonies, because as Varroa weakens that one colony, neighboring colonies may come to rob it. And when they come to rob the resources, the Varroa get on workers from those neighboring colonies and hitchhike back to those colonies in the apiary. Furthermore, so that's through the robbing behavior, but furthermore, bees that are heavily infested with Varroa also have a tendency to drift. They will go to the wrong colonies in the apiary. I once read a research paper years ago where someone hypothesized Varroa might have actually even rigged this behavior to cause bees to spread it. Whether or not that's the case is still unknown, but it's remarkable to know that colonies that are heavily infested with Varroa tend to drift more than those that don't. Of course, we as beekeepers are big spreaders of Varroa. If we've got that one colony again that's got Varroa in the apiary, we routinely move supers between hives, we swap places between hives, we take frames of brood from strong colonies and put in weak colonies, and maybe bees from certain colonies into others. We homogenize the bee population in our apiary, and we then can spread Varroa just by moving boxes and bees, etc. Varroa also spread through migratory beekeeping operations. We load bees on the back of our trucks and we take them somewhere. All of these ways are ways that facilitate the spread of Varroa once they get into an area. Beyond that, it's really important to know what Varroa's life cycle is so that you can understand how they impact the bees. Let's have a closer look at the Varroa life cycle. Let's just say, for the sake of argument, that female Varroa have entered your colony own the backs of infested adult bees. So let's just start with that phrase, adult female varroa. The only varroa that most beekeepers will ever see is the adult female, and that's because she's the only one who will come out of the brood cells and infest adult bees. So let's start with that varroa who's on the back of that bee. She is reproductive and ready to go into a brood cell. Varroa reproduce on honeybee brood, and what they will do is before a cell is capped, while it still contains a developing larval bee, the varroa, the female varroa, will crawl down between the larva and the cell wall and embed herself in the brood food that's underneath that larva. Once the larva finishes eating its food and the cell is capped by worker bees, the varroa will crawl out from underneath that developing larva, or that prepupa at this stage, and will begin to feed on that prepupae. The female varroa will lay her first egg, which is always a male, about 60 hours after the cell is capped. And then she'll begin laying subsequent eggs that will all be female at about a 30-hour interval. So now, if you imagine then that just one varroa goes into that cell, then her son is mating with her daughters, making the varroa inbred, but that is perfectly acceptable in the varroa world. It is a natural way that they reproduce and mate. Now, of course, you can get more than one varroa going into a cell. If multiple female varroa go into a cell, then there would be offspring from multiple females available to mate with offspring from the other females. Incidentally, these females that go into the cells, we refer to as foundress mites. They're essentially the founding members of the parasitized brood in that cell. Once you get the feeding activity of multiple mite individuals, you will start to see mite feces building up within the cell. These mites will continue to develop and feed upon the bee, at this stage transferring viruses. Now, I want to speak a little bit about these immature mites. This immature male mite will never leave the cell alive. He is always a white, soft-bodied mite. And so when you go into a cell that's got mite offspring, it's really easy to confuse the male mite, if you're not sure what you're looking at, with developing stages of the female mite. But the male mite will fully mature in the cell. He will always be a white-bodied individual, whereas the females go through the same developmental stages, are also white-bodied individuals until the latter stage when their body hardens, a process we call sclerotization, becomes that oval shape and that reddish-brown color that we recognize with varroas. And that adult bee will emerge, be it a worker or a drone, etc. And when that adult bee emerges, she carries with her the original foundress mites, if they are still alive, and any fully mature female mites that were produced in that cell. And the reason I say fully mature is that there are mites in that cell of various stages, and a lot of those don't reach maturity before the bee emerges, therefore they die when the other bees come in to clean out that cell, etc. So the only mites that exit the cell with the adult bee are those foundress mites that survive the process, as well as any new fully mature, sexually ready adult female mites. Now, what's interesting about this is this newly emerged bee will carry those mites out of the cell on her body. Those mites might go to other bees and feed for a few days. This is especially true of those newly developed adult female mites who have to feed a couple of days to be capable of laying eggs. So you've got these adult mites feeding on these adult bees, and then when they're ready to begin laying eggs, they go back into the cell of these uncapped larvae and start the process all over again. Now, mites have a propensity to go to drone brood. They much prefer drone brood to worker brood. They still reproduce in worker brood. Don't get me wrong. They produce a lot of offspring on worker brood. But they prefer to go to drone brood because drones take an additional 3 days to develop, which makes it possible for varroa to produce even more fully mature female offspring that are ready to mate. And so when this process happens in the nest, you can get very quick, explosive populations of varroa that become quite damaging. Now think about everything that I've just told you with the life cycle, right? Varroa invading brood cells, varroa reproducing, varroa spreading diseases and pests. All of these are ways that they contribute ultimately to colony mortality. So let's look at these specifically. Varroa transmit pathogens. One of the most notable pathogens being deformed wing virus. When varroa are parasitizing an immature bee while that bee is developing, the varroa can be a transmitter of deformed wing virus. Not only are varroa transmitting pathogens such as deformed wing virus and other viruses, but the sheer act of feeding on bees damages the bees. Varroa are really small. They're really difficult to see for most beekeepers, but relative to the size of their host, they have one of the largest parasite host ratios known currently. That means relative to the size of the honeybee, it's one of the largest parasites known. I often tell people it would be somewhere in the neighborhood of a softball to a volleyball sized tick on our body if we were to scale varroa up to the size of us as it is to the size of a bee. So this big thing physically putting holes in immature bees, putting holes in adult bees, and consuming the fat bodies, the hemolymph, the other tissues in the bees, these things are incredibly damaging just to the health of those parasitized bees. So you get disease spread, you get mechanical and physical damage from the varroa physically feeding on those bees, and all of this results in bees with shortened lifespans, bees with shortened productivity. If the brood is heavily parasitized and the bees are trying to combat that by removing out those diseased brood, you get very spotty brood patterns. And as that brood pattern becomes spottier and spottier and the varroa population goes up and up, you get diseased brood, malformed brood. You get adults being born that are incapable of contributing productively to the nest. You get fewer adults being born, and ultimately you get an absolute collapse of the nest. It's devastating. And I could go through a whole litany of different things that honeybees encounter, from bacterial diseases to fungal diseases to arthropod pests to nutrition issues to queen-related issues, but biologically, Varroa destructor represents the greatest threat to managed honeybees currently on planet Earth. Now, we could argue about pollution threats and human threats, but I would just say from a non-human standpoint, varroa is king. It's what's there working in your colonies, even right now, to kill your bees. If you are not killing varroa, you can assume that they are killing bees. They are bad news. They are bad business. And as a beekeeper, you have to understand when your varroa populations have reached levels that need to be controlled, what to do to control them, and a lot of that is simply linked to understanding the natural life cycle of a honeybee colony, and in this video, the natural biology of the varroa itself.